Calling to order the Monday, June 1st, 2015 regular meeting of the 35th Council of the City of Berkeley. Ms. Vecchio, would you please call the roll?
Councilmember Baker.
Here.
Councilmember Blanchard.
Here.
Councilmember Edgar.
Here.
Councilmember Kadeko.
Here.
Councilmember Stedman. Mayor Pro Tem Terbrack.
Here.
Mayor O'Dwyer.
Here. Now, the first order of business is the approval of the agenda. Is there a motion to approve tonight's agenda?
Move to approve tonight's agenda.
Support.
Approved by Councilmember Kadeko with support by Councilmember Edgar. Ms. Vecchio, would you please call the roll?
Blanchard.
Yes.
Edgar.
Yes.
Kadeko.
Yes.
Terbrack.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. And now would you please stand for the invocation? I see Reverend Tal Sullivan with us.
Let you in, then I'll stand up.
There we go.
Let's pray. God, I thank you for the words of the psalmist in Psalm 118:24, which says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." And God, we are thankful for the breath in our lungs, thankful for the health that we have, the ability to be here, the ability to conduct business, the ability, God, to lead our city well. Thank you, God, for a wonderful city that you've blessed us with. I thank you for the leaders that you have given us. I thank you for the wisdom that you give them. I thank you for the provision that you have given us. And I pray that in this meeting, right decisions will be made, and you'll continue to guide us and direct us in these days ahead. God, we thank you. This time of year, we remember many who are graduating from school. They're finishing up in one area of life, and they're getting ready to move into other areas. We pray for our graduates, that they will flourish, that they will make wise choices, and that the education that they've received would serve them well and serve this community well. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
And please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now we come to the citizens' comments portion of tonight's meeting, when you may present your thoughts on items not included on tonight's agenda. Council members will not engage you in discussion. If your concern needs to be addressed by a member of the city staff or a department of the city, please sign your name provided in the sheet at the clerk's desk. When you come to the microphone, please state your name and city of residence. Well, seeing no one coming to the microphone, then we move on to the next item, the consent agenda. Ms. Vecchio, would you please read the items on tonight's consent agenda?
Approval of the minutes. Matter of approving the minutes of the 35th City Council Budget Work Session on Monday, May 11th, 2015, Budget Work Session on Tuesday, May 12th, 2015, and the regular meeting on Monday, May 18th, 2015.
Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Motion to approve.
Support.
Motion to approve by Councilmember Blanchard. Support by Councilmember Baker. Ms. Vecchio, would you please call the roll?
Edgar.
Yes.
Kadeko.
Yes.
Stedman.
Yes.
Terbrack.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
Blanchard.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. And now we come to the regular agenda. Ms. Vecchio, would you please read the first item on tonight's regular agenda?
Recognitions and presentations.
Seeing none on the consent agenda, then we move on to item number two, please.
Presentation. To welcome and introduce Art Serafinski to the City Council as the city's newly appointed Parks and Recreation Director.
Is there a motion to approve this presentation?
Move to approve.
Move to approve by Mayor Pro Tem Terbrack with support by Councilmember Kadeko. Mr. Sessit.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, City Council. Good evening to residents and visitors to our meeting. Under this item, it gives me great pleasure and a great honor to introduce to you our new Director of Parks and Recreation, Mr. Art Serafinski. I believe you have a copy of his resume that's attached for you. And this, I decided to take this time to introduce him, not just to the City Council, but also to the public. He has worked, he's been working with us now for 1 week, approximately 1 week, and he's already got his sleeves rolled up, ready to get to work. He comes to us from Ypsilanti Township, where he was the director for Parks and Recreation there. What I'd like to do is to ask him now to just simply approach City Council and tell us a little bit about himself. But before you do, let me just give a little bit more background, and forgive me, I should have done this ahead of time. Council, we did review a total of 14 applicants that did come before us. After we reviewed the applicants, we selected four to do a first review, interview. From there, we chose two applicants, and obviously Mr. Serafinski was one of the finalists. And after much review, backgrounds, references, the choice was obvious, and my recommendation and selection was Mr. Art Serafinski as our new director of Parks and Recreation. I think he has a tremendous background. I'm hoping that he'll tell you a little bit about it. And also, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the staff who assisted me in this interview process, and that included our library director, Mr. Matt Church, our director of public works, Mr. Derek Schuler, and my assistant, Darshell Strickland Love. And they assisted me in developing the questions and conducting the interview and things of that nature, and I think it went very, very well. So with that, I'd like to introduce you now to Mr. Art Serafinski. Welcome, and thank you, Art.
Thank you. I just want to start off, Honorable Mayor, members of council, and members of the audience. I really want to thank you guys, and especially Jane, for this fantastic opportunity. A little bit about myself. She did mention that I was Parks and Rec director for the city of, or for the township of Ypsilanti. I also had stints in the city of Saline, the city of Centerline, and the city of Monroe. Parks and Recreation is my passion. Leisure services is my passion. Been doing it a lot of years. I love getting involved through Michigan Recreation Park Association. I've held offices of president, secretary, and I've chaired just about every committee they've had. Amateur softball, I was president of that regional group, so this is something that's near and dear to me. I think, though I'm a little bit older and I do have the experience, I can go back to Kevin Price, I can go back to Bob Tooley, for those who have lived here a long time, and always respected the city of Berkley. So to have this opportunity is fantastic. I've been here 1 week, and so far I've been greeted with open arms. I have a wonderful staff. The department heads have been wonderful, and slowly but surely I'm getting to meet some of the groups that use the community center, and I'm looking forward to Cruise Fest, to Summer Fest, Fall Fest, and all the things you can do. Hopefully you'll appreciate my efforts. I do put a lot of time into it, but I thoroughly enjoy it. And my goal is to continue the great tradition that Berkley has and to grow upon it. And I think with the team that I have and the support that I have, I think it'll happen. So have a little patience. It's only been 1 week. There's lots to learn. But I'm up for the challenge. And again, thank you so much. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you. Any questions, comments? Mayor Pro Tem Terbrack.
Thank you. As the liaison from the council to the Parks and Recreation Board, I certainly welcome you, and I look forward to working with you. We have a meeting coming up next week, as we talked about earlier. When you were giving your brief introduction, you mentioned something that I want to maybe expand a little bit more on. You mentioned something about playing softball.
Yes. Okay, my experience with that, in college I played...
Stats, please.
Yeah, I played college baseball, but in regards to softball, I've been Michigan Amateur Softball Association Commissioner for almost 25 years now. I've been president of that association. I'm still a district commissioner and regional director. And my playing days have dwindled a little bit. I've played.
I only need you once a year.
Yep. I have played organized softball for 35 years. Right now, my heart in softball is umpiring. I've had the ability to do about 30 states. I've done a couple nationals. I've actually went out to Bismarck and I'm Team USA that you might have seen on TV the last couple of years, who participate in the border-to-border battles.
That's excellent.
As a player, I can still hit it.
Good question. qualifies
That's even better.
There you go.
Can you catch? Just
yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Doesn't that qualify him as captain?
That's all that matters.
We, as you will find out, there's just one softball game around here that actually
I just
matters.
Missed it, yeah.
You did just miss it, and we certainly look forward to having you next year. And all kidding aside, welcome again to the city, to the Parks and Recreation, to the department. And there's a lot of great things that we're doing in the city, but there's a lot of great things that we can be doing. Mm-hmm. And just by, you know, when your energy and your passion right now, I can tell that, you know, it is certainly where your heart is. And that's exactly what we're looking for, and I can't wait to start working with you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dan. Anybody else?
Just a quick comment, Your Honor. Just somebody, at least somebody knows the softball rules. So when the dads club is trying to
cheat,
pull these shenanigans that they try and pull, we've got somebody on our side that knows the rules.
Are there any dads club members in the audience?
No. Dan Irwin, too, if you're listening.
Okay, very good. Well, Art, we are certainly delighted to have you. You get to lead a vibrant, energetic team of people. The advisory board there, the employees there are passionate, dedicated, and I think you'll enjoy leading and guiding and being innovative in that department. So we're glad to have you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And now, Ms. Vecchio, would you please read item number 3?
Motion number M3115, matter of approving the appointment of Alonda Knox to serve on the Downtown Development Authority Board of Trustees as a 12-mile representative with a term ending July 2019.
Is there a motion to approve M3115?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve by Councilmember Baker.
Support.
Support by Councilmember Stedman. Mr. Sessa.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Again, as the city administrator, the city manager, I have the responsibility of making a recommendation to the city council, which the city council considers and hopefully will finalize my recommendation. But tonight, I'm recommending Alanda Knox to the DDA board. We have two vacancies right now. One is on 12 Mile, and the other one, I'm either going to fill it with someone from Coolidge or perhaps a resident is what I'm looking at, one of those two. But for now, Alanda Knox is a businesswoman here in the city of Berkeley. She has been a business owner in the city of Berkeley for a little over 2 years. I've met her. As a matter of fact, I got to visit her when she did her first ribbon cutting at her business. And she is with us this evening, so I'm sure you'd like to meet her and she might say a few words. But just to give you a little background, as I said, Alanda Knox is a business owner. She has more than 25 years of experience as a business professional. She retired from the Sisters of Mercy Corp after 6 years of service. And she deals with counseling children ages from 4 to 7. And she also worked as a special education research for people with special needs in the Ypsilanti public school system. And she has been a business owner in the city of Berkeley for a little over 2 years. When asked the question about what are her interests and qualifications for this appointment, she believes that as the owner of M2U, her goal is to provide her clients with stylish, high-quality clothing and things of that nature. But as an entrepreneur, she views things from a little different perspective. She likes to help others along the way, as she says, and she would like the opportunity to help make Berkeley a destination for retail shoppers in the Southeast Michigan region. And she believes that she can help support economic initiatives in our community. When asked the question, list other information that she feels would be pertinent in assisting the city council in their selection. And I guess her statement here is about Berkeley. She says that she chose the city of Berkeley because of its walkability. She feels that it has a true downtown feel, that it's a safe community. She loves and enjoys the free parking. She feels that the environment is warm and welcoming. And so her last statement, she says that she encourages others to come and experience this not only in her store, but in the other shops and businesses located in the downtown authority region. And I can personally attest to that. I've walked into her office, into her store a couple of times with other business interested people who are interested in coming to the city of Berkley, and she's there first in line to tell people about our city and her good experience as a business owner, and just a complete and total supporter of the downtown region. So with that, City Council, it gives me great honor to recommend Ms. Alanda Knox to the position of DDA Board.
Thank you. Are there any questions or discussion on this nomination? Councilmember Baker.
Thank you, Your Honor, and Ms. DeSessa, thank you for bringing this to us tonight so we have the opportunity to vote. As liaison to the DDA, I had the pleasure of meeting her at our last meeting, and it was a great pleasure to do so. Not only can I attest to that same that positive energy and spirit that you bring, but I also have very high confidence in the work ethic and determination that you will bring to that board to help to contribute to help advance our region even further. So I welcome you aboard and thank you for your service to the city and the region.
Thank you. Councilmember Edgar.
Thank you. I just want to say that if she does half the job on the board as she does merchandising her shop, it will be a huge benefit. Thank you.
Very nice. Thank you. Well, if you would like to come to the microphone and make a comment or two, that'd be nice.
Mayor and Council, and especially Jane, I would like to thank you for this opportunity. The city has been so open and welcoming, and the downtown area is just growing, and it's great, and I really look forward to working with you guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And so, Ms. Vecchio, would you please call the roll on M3115?
Kadeckel.
Yes.
Stedman.
Yes.
Terbrick.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
Blanchard.
Yes.
Edgar.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. Congratulations. Thank you for serving.
Thank you.
And now, Ms. Vecchio, would you please read item number 4?
Motion number M3215, matter of approving participation in the Turn the Town Teal campaign to promote awareness of ovarian cancer and its symptoms.
Is there a motion to approve M3215?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve.
Support.
By Councilmember Stedman, support by Councilmember Edgar. Ms. DeSessa.
Mr. Mayor, City Council, you know, usually we have Marsha Gerchi come to this meeting. Unfortunately, she had an event that she could not miss, and she expresses her apologies for not being able to attend. But this is something that's very near and dear to her, and obviously this is a campaign that I would recommend for you to consider. This would be the third time that we've done this. It'll be our third year. And they've done an excellent job. They've worked with us very closely. They brought the ribbons in a very professional manner, or very well. They put them up and they take them down, very, very good. As soon as the term is over. But just for the residents out there, since Marcia isn't here, to tell you a little bit about what Turn the Town's Teal is all about. It's basically a national campaign to promote awareness of ovarian cancer and its symptoms. And this campaign was founded by Gail McNeil of Chatham, New Jersey, who was inspired by her own experiences. Since then, this program came to be, and now cities and states, throughout the United States, are part of this campaign. And with that, I would like to recommend that the City Council consider this request.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Questions? We've been through.
This being a comment that their track record has been exceptional. Like Jane has said, that they get the stuff up and get it down in a very timely manner. So I think the residents should appreciate that.
And beyond that, this is a really important issue for women. Ovarian cancer can be present a significant amount of time before it is detected. And the importance of early detection cannot be overstated. And so this is a good program and a good thing to remind people of the importance of early checking and medical care to prevent these kinds of cancers. And so, Ms. Vecchio, you please call the roll on M3215.
Stedman?
Yes.
Terbrick?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
Blanchard?
Yes.
Edgar?
Yes.
Kadeckel?
Yes.
O'Dwyer?
Yes. Now, Ms. Vecchio, would you please read item number 5?
Motion number M3315, matter of considering a proposal from Carrot Pass LLC concerning the Carrot Pass Exclusive City Program.
Is there a motion to approve M3315?
Motion to approve.
Support.
Motion to approve by Councilmember Baker, support by Mayor Pro Tem Terbrack. Mr. Sessa.
City Council, this is an unusual request that's come before you. It is a proposal like something that I've never heard of before approach the City of Berkley. Please know that they did meet with the Downtown Development Authority just to explain and introduce themselves. When I first met with them, that is who they wanted to meet with first, with our Downtown Development Authority. No action was taken at the meeting. However, they did mention that they wanted to present a proposal to the city with regards to their Carrot Pass program. I know that representatives are here, and I'm going to let them explain in more detail as to what this proposal is all about. I know that several of you have asked me many questions about this proposal. I hope I've given you the answers that you're looking for. I did send it via email, but I made a copy of it just in case, so you can go back and read it, or you can ask them again the questions. But basically, and forgive me, I hope I don't oversimplify this, because I'll let you make the presentation. Maybe that's what I should do. Just let them go and do the presentation, and this way we can move forward. So with that, I'd like to have Walter and Michael, or whoever's going to give the presentation. Michael? Okay. And Council, this is the creator of the mobile app. So, if you don't mind, just introduce yourself to the City Council and explain your proposal. Thank you.
First, thank you, Jane, and thank you, Mr. Mayor, and fellow councilmen and women for having me here tonight. Hopefully, we'll be able to answer any of your questions and concerns that you may have about our program. Thank you, everyone in the audience, for hearing me out. First, I'd like to say, Carrot Pass is a 20-week-old application. It's a mobile application that was founded in Royal Oak. And it was made by a company called Marvel Apps, which I am the CEO of. It's made by a small group of teams that are in Michigan. Everyone that works at Marvel Apps went to Michigan State, Michigan. We're all from Michigan. It's a really homegrown product, and we're very proud of that. I want to give you a little background about it, 2 minutes on this. We first started out this application in January of 2014. And at that time, I don't know if you recall, but it was a pretty harsh winter. Being that we're in Royal Oak, we often ate at restaurants in Royal Oak. And one of the restaurants that we often visited was Zumba's Mexican Grill, which was by the Imagine Theater. Well, we came in on a Tuesday, and I had been going to the Zumba's since 1999, when I was working at Chrysler. And I really just knew the owner, Tim, by face, pleasantries, politeness, just saying hi. We came in on a Tuesday, and he personally thanked us for being there. We're the only ones in his whole shop. It just snowed. I have a Jeep, so I typically take my guys out, and we go out for lunch, no matter what, on Tuesdays. And so, it was a Tuesday. He sat down with us and ate lunch with us and said, "You guys are the first lunch customers I had since Friday." And that really hit me hard because it was a harsh winter, but it was something that it really hit my core. And at the end of this lunch, it just overcame me. I said, "Hey, Tim, if there's anything I can do for you, please let me know what I can do." And he said, "I don't even know what you guys do. I just want to thank you." And at that time, that's when I told him that we were app developers. And I decided to make him an app to attract people into his store. And that's what really spawned Carrot, was just the ability to attract customers into stores in a different manner. And what Carrot is a mobile app that's made for iPhone and Android to reward people financially for being healthy. So we use the pedometer of the phone to track the number of steps you take. And for every single step you take, you earn a reward point. And for every single, like, 10,000 reward points, we ask the carrot merchants to provide financial rewards for their customers. So for instance, at Zumba's Mexican Grill, you can get a free pop with 10,000 points, or a free burrito with 20,000 points, or 20,000 steps. So the idea is you can use these steps to get a little bit more, you know, everybody can be a little bit more healthier and just be a little bit more active, and you can redeem these steps or points for merchandise or for discounts at certain stores. Now we're 20 weeks old, we're in about 230 plus merchants. When we talk about, we're located mostly in Royal Oak, but we're in downtown Detroit, Southfield, and Birmingham. We're moving into Ann Arbor now, and you know, we've been featured on Fox 2 as well as Channel 4 for this product, and we're really excited about this. And this is what we wanted to extend. What we learned from the city of Royal Oak, who was the first city to adopt Carrot, is to approach the DDAs and join the chambers, but also really offer it up to the city. And that's what we did with the city of Royal Oak. We offered basically a partnership to the city to provide messaging to everyone's mobile phone with our beacon. So once you're within 200 feet of this device, then we'll send out a message to your phone, whatever message you want to provide, you know, free parking, for instance, or free parking this weekend, or there's an event this weekend. And that's how the city of Royal Oak is using it. We put beacons at their farmer's market. Phase two is going to put it in their parking structures, and just to put awareness out there that you park 2 hours for free at these parking structures during the week.
Very good. Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. I did a lot of research on this. One of the things that was interesting to me, and you just kind of mentioned it, so if there was something at City Hall, one of the beacons were at City Hall, when they got within that, you know, 200-foot range, something would get pushed to their phone, correct? And it would pop up and say, X is happening here. And the same thing with retail stores. So if you're walking by Zumba's, for example, and you walk past, the thing will come up on your phone. Now, is this, if you have a certain number of steps, it'll be, you know, free drink or free bread? I mean, is that, so it's all connected to the pedometer?
It's all connected through the app. You don't have to have the app running or in the background. What it will do is this will send a signal to the phone that had downloaded the app. Mm-hmm. And what we try to do is provide a compelling reason why you should go into a store you've never visited.
Right.
And that what we're finding in from doing this for 20 weeks is people tend to visit a new store knowing that their friends either like it or have visited there before. Okay, so what we try to do is provide a compelling reason why you should go to Zumba's if you've never visited that before, and that will be 10 of your friends like it. And then once you slide open that message, because it's your first time going to Zumba's, you get $2 off. Okay. So it's not necessarily a deal that entices them into the store.
Yeah, I kind of envision it, at least in my head, is that, so I'm walking down 12 Mile and I walk past whichever of our businesses have the beacon there, and I walk past and whoop, something pops up. You know, something's going on here today, or there's some deal here, and I can, you know, walk down a little further, whatever they, I mean, I know not every business obviously would have them. So it's, you know, your people are walking past, and we are a walkable community. We want people to walk through our downtown, and as you walk through these, you walk down 12 Mile or Coolidge or wherever it is, you're getting something popping up saying, you know, stop in here to try to drive traffic to that store.
Correct.
I'm assuming.
What we did is we optimized this. It took us 12 months to make this, from February to December of last year to make this. And we optimized the experience. So you only get one message that dynamically changes when you're in front of that store.
Okay.
You won't get 30 messages just because you ran down the street.
Okay.
Right? You'll get one message.
I was going to be in my next question. So if I'm just jogging, I'm going
to... Oh, no, it's a great question. I think that's what really sets us apart alongside of walking, right? You're getting rewarded for walking, and that's what we want to do. Right? It's what we sell it for $2 a day to the merchants to get unlimited messaging, couponing, and get all the analytics that are emailed to you every day at 8 o'clock in the morning. So you know how many people have walked past your store, how many people, this is all anonymous, or if people want to opt in and share their information, they can do this. But what we're finding is 65% sign in anonymously. And typically what happens is we can tell you, based on where they visited, if they are a female, male, or anything like that.
As long as they have the app on their device. Right.
But it is very private, Everything is stored on everyone's phone. It's never stored on our servers. So if they delete the app, they delete everything that that phone learned about them. Because what the phone does, it just provides messages that make sense to you.
So those analytics you just mentioned that businesses have access to as part of their membership in Carrot, you mentioned for $2 a day they can be
correct
part of that. For the city, those same analytics would apply, for example, if we put one in City Hall, so if somebody walked past, we would
correct
have an idea of the kind of traffic we're, foot traffic that's going by here.
Correct. And what we find is,
or our library or wherever else we decide to.
Correct. And that's one of the things that we're adding to the Royal Oak is a public library. One, they put the number, the hours of operation, and you know, all the different traffic that goes from the farmer's market through into the city through the public library. So they're able to find out foot traffic for the number of people that walked down there or down the street by the police station, right? So they can get an idea how effective the farmer's market is in attracting people to then, you know, visit any restaurants inside the city.
But of course, it only tells you the people who have this device on their phone. So it doesn't give you any information about who's going to the library and how many people and what times they're going.
It went with the beacon that's set at the library, we do find out how long they've been in the library,
yeah.
Correct. Yeah.
For
so
the people who have the app.
They have the app, that's correct.
That's the key limitation.
go ahead.
My question kind of is, why does the city need to be involved in this at all?
Well, one of the things that we learned from the city of Royal Oak is we want the city to participate in this. We want everybody to share your messaging, because there's a lot of times in the city of Royal Oak that I would love to gotten message that there might be a 5K run this weekend, other than just, you know, seeing it on the newspaper or anything like that. So this is what we learned is we developed a package that by having beacons at the city, at City Hall or even the public library or other designated areas that you would like to find traffic for, mm-hmm. or information for, we can see a definite benefit for you. And that's what we're seeing from the city at the farmers market or at different events. And with that said, what we're offering is we're gonna give 10% off to all merchants that sign on with the city. And then we're gonna donate 10% back to any charitable function that the city wants to donate any of this revenue that was generated through if the city were to accept this partnership.
So this is contingent then upon enough businesses purchasing, paying $800 or whatever it is a year.
It's only contingent on there's no strings attached at all. We would love to offer you this. This partnership is, you know, is free, and it's a value that's, you know, it's significant to us. But we feel like there's a huge value for the city, as we're finding in other cities.
Very good, Councilor Baker.
Thank you, Your Honor, and thank you guys for coming out. As mentioned earlier, I have had the pleasure of not only meeting our new board member at the DDA, but got to see your presentation there as well. And so I downloaded the app and have used it the last couple of weeks, including the farmers market at Royal Oak and that kind of stuff. And I was asking myself that exact same kind of question. I know we'll get into the finances again in a minute and things like that. But so as I understand it, you're coming here tonight to talk with us is sort of in parallel to and not really related to the outreach that you're doing to the businesses, right? You have your program, you're reaching out, you're going to be signing up those businesses.
Correct.
And so they can continue to do that whether or not we choose to leverage this for our own purposes as well.
That's correct.
So when I turn to what's in it for Berkley, I think about some of these same kinds of scenarios that you describe from the library. If someone were to be walking by or riding their bicycle or something, and they get a little information about there's a speaker coming in on Saturday to talk about a book signing or something like that, that would be interesting. Also, like we have the Art Bash coming up and the Lids for Kids and things. If we were to have one of these beacons near the public safety building, we could better understand the traffic flow in terms of, you know, the people that have attended, how long they stayed, whereabouts within the region they were at, and then we can learn from that, because I think the excellent point about for an organization like ours, it's really about the data. It's and then being able to take action based on that data. So if we had an event and we had lower turnout than we thought or higher turnout than we thought, the data would tell us that, and then we could ask better questions about, you know, traffic flow and how people are walking and engaging with the region. So I think from that perspective, it can help inform us as Art and the other folks in Parks and Rec and us in other functions, again, like the Art Bash and things like that, want to provide even better services and better experiences to our residents. This gives us some data to do that. So I think there's some benefit in exploring this, and I'm open to hearing more about the nature of the partnership and the fact that this helps continue to promote our work to remain a progressive technology city that applies this not only for our residents but also for internal use as well.
Yes, you can control all your messaging through an iPhone or an iPad to designated people that you desire.
Well, I also have it on my phone, but I haven't used it yet. I just downloaded it to understand where this is going, and I can see how it works, and I can see the value. The only limitation is the data is limited to those folks who have this app on their phone.
Yes.
And so if we had a wide-ranging use of it, it would be more useful, obviously,
absolutely.
Data.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you begin somewhere, I suppose.
I assume
yes.
That's
Mr. Mayor,
that.
I may add yeah. One thing is, here's the, we are 20 weeks old. We understand that it's kind of a chicken or the egg who comes first, right? This is the press release that's going to be given by the Fifth Third Michigan State Fair, Fifth Third Bank Michigan State Fair. We're the official app for the Michigan State Fair, where they're expecting 110,000 visitors this year. What they're using Carrot for is getting all the analytics of where everybody goes in the State Fair, as well as ordering tickets to the Michigan State Fair through the Carrot app. So at designated merchants that want to participate in this program, as soon as you enter in, you can buy Michigan State Fair tickets through the app and then redeem them at the fair. So you can bypass the line and go from there. But you're looking at 110,000 visitors that, as the primary to experience the Michigan State Fair, to download the app and you know enjoy the fair.
Councilmember Edgar.
Thank you, Your Honor. How many people do you have enrolled in your app right now?
So there's about, in the terms of merchants, there's about 235 merchants that have the app. The app has been downloaded. We just released it for Android about a week and a half ago, and I think we have about 500 downloads of the Android version so okay. far. 35% of those are in Vietnam, but there's a lot of interest in a lot of places for this. There's over 15,000 in a 10-mile radius of Royal Oak right now, so that includes Berkeley.
15,000 with the iPad.
With yeah. the iPhone. That's with only
or the iPad.
The Apple device, really. When I downloaded the data for the analytics for downtown, this is about 30 merchants in Royal Oak. You're looking at from May 1st to yesterday, you're looking at 2,700 visitors. This is just iPhone users.
Nice.
That had stayed at places more than 5 minutes in those 35 places. 98 people had visited new places in the course of 30 days in Royal Oak. There's been, when we break it down to when all the visitors throughout the day they visit, so 780 were between 8 a.m. and noon, 730 were between noon and 4, and 4 to close was 671. So we break all these analytics down, and they're all anonymous, but it helps you understand
the businesses
what they want to, where do they want to, how they want to advertise, and at what times they want to advertise.
Right. Thank you.
Councilor Blanchard.
Thank you, Your Honor. This is free for the city the first year. What's the cost to the city for the second year?
It's completely free for the second year as well.
That's not what it was implied in your thing that you sent us.
That's for the businesses.
There was something. There was the beacons for the city. There was a cost.
If you
12 months.
It was so for merchants. There's a year one cost and a year two cost for merchants, because you have to have a device.
It says here, five free 12-month Carrot licenses, $32 value. That says 12 months. This includes one Carrot starter kit, and this is for the city police stations, fire.
Mm-hmm. Wherever we want to place it, Your Honor.
So that implies that there's a cost for the second year.
Yeah, I guess we didn't put that on the proposal that, it's free for this next year. It's pretty much free for the city to use as long as they want to use it.
So that would be something we'd want to clarify, if I may, Your Honor. Yeah. We'd want to clarify that for sure before we get into it. But
that's right, because the follow-up question is, if it's free for the second year, how about the third year?
Yep.
I mean, is there a trap that we might be popping over the edge on?
I completely understand that, and we can put that in the proposal.
Okay, thank you.
But there is no cost.
That there is no cost to the city.
Right. Yeah. Okay. That's what it says here.
Councilmember Cadet.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you. A couple questions. Number one, a lot of times when you're phone goes dead or you're transferring information, you lose your apps and you have to re-download everything. Is that information stored? Like if I'm transferring getting a new phone from an Android 5 to an Android 6, whatever, sometimes I have to re-download the information. Now I have that good health where it counts the steps and it's stored in there already. Is that the same type of thing?
So for Android, it gets stored on the Google servers, all your steps. Okay. Right, so that should carry over depending on how you have your settings on your app. But we put it on for default reasons, and then for Apple, it just it gets stored through the cloud for them as well.
And the other question is about the ticket sales. There's some nonprofit organizations within the city that will sell tickets to events. How would that work for them? You know, if it's a one-time deal.
So the way we do ticket sales for the Michigan State Fair is we charge 79 cents per ticket, and that includes all the transaction costs that are associated to the card transfers and all those transaction fees. So we can work with all the different organizations you'd like to put on. If you just want in your area, based on this beacon, to send out, buy these tickets for this event, we can do that as well.
Okay. Yeah. At 79 cents.
At 79 cents. That's our transactions fee that we have at the bank.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Your Honor.
Mayor Pro Tem.
All right, a few more, thank you. Cost for someone to download the app?
It is absolutely free for consumers.
Right, I know that, but just want to make sure that everybody else knew that as well. So the app does not cost anything. So if the city were to enter into this partnership with you, the city gets X amount of worth of free things, what do you get out of that?
Well, we would like to say that the city of Berkeley is participating in this program.
And I would think even more so than just saying that, it would be incumbent upon us, the city, to make sure that our residents knew that we were on this and knew that this is something that we were involved in. So we would obviously be doing a lot of promotional work, I would think, on our websites, and businesses that have it, what it would have, I don't know if there's just a logo they can pull or, you know, and say we're on Carrot Pass. But yeah, and for us to actually be able to cultivate any data, we would want to make sure that a lot of our residents knew about this and had this. Otherwise, if five of our residents, you know, had it and nobody else knew about it, we would only know where those five people go. And that wouldn't do a whole lot. And I guess my final question is actually, I have two questions, that was a lie. What's the downside for us? What is the downside for the city of Berkeley here?
You know, we discuss this quite a lot, and we always talk about the upside. There's just tremendous upside. It's free. Sure. It provides great analytics. It's very easy to make your messages. It takes 30 seconds a day to make one message. You can share it on Facebook and Twitter with just one tap after you make that message. So throughout all your social media, you can send, you know, you can get it done within a minute. A very simple message. If there's any downside that I, you know, it's hard. It's the way we have it, the program and the proposal together, it's hard to come to a downside about it. It's really win for everyone. Like you, to answer your second question, we would definitely appreciate any marketing to help get downloads. Mm-hmm. We are definitely going through our own marketing campaign to get as many people to download. Download the app. We're making partnerships with Healthy Detroit in downtown. We have the Michigan State Fair. There's a number of other programs that you'll be hearing pretty soon, and we're hoping to announce them sooner than later. But we're 20 weeks into this, and we're excited about it. So
20 weeks in, is this a beta version that we're working with now, and you're working things out?
The beta version actually happened last year. I used all of Tim's stuff to do the beta version. And he had 3,500 downloads in the first month. Okay. And with that, he was able to push people information within a 1 mile radius to say, get $5 off a taco today, for instance. So those are the types of things that we were able to experiment with him that made sense. And that's how we developed Carrot.
Okay, Thank you.
Okay, I have one little quick question for our attorney. When we use words like partnership with the city, does that incur, or could that incur a liability for us? I mean, clearly we'd have to see an agreement to know what that might do, but just your sense of it.
Well, partnership by its nature, if there are partners, legal, technical partners, all partners can be liable. My sense of the way we're using the word tonight is not a partnership in the legal form, but just more of a
association,
a descriptive, associative term that okay. We would have a contractual relationship with Carrot, but we would not actually be partners
okay. In
the legal sense.
Okay, very good. Councilor Bacon.
Thank you again, Your Honor, and thanks for the continued dialogue here. You can tell this is these are exciting frontiers as we see how and in what ways we can, as the city manager opened the conversation here, this is new for us, right, to form this kind of partnership. And so I think I have a couple of questions in here. I won't try to enumerate them before I, enunciate them, if you will. But I just made that up, too. But just to kind of recap, so there's no cost to the end user, shopper, people. They can download it. It is their choice to do so, so certainly they don't have to download it. So if they choose to not, then that's potentially missing out.
Exactly. They get to opt in for any information they want to share.
Yep.
They have to opt to download the app themselves.
Sure. And then hopefully, again, what I appreciate about the naming that you've even chosen, this carrot, right? You are dangling a carrot, an enticement to encourage something, and what you're basically encouraging is healthy behavior, because the rewards are based on steps. So again,
right.
I didn't want to lose sight of what it is that this is actually, the kind of societal benefit that this could drive. I was mentioned earlier the walkability of Berkeley, so I can certainly understand why you'd want to target our folks who do a lot of walking anyway. You know, it's
correct.
Might as well go get the discount or whatever it is that's being offered. I had similar questions in terms of partnership with a lowercase p in terms of those kinds of things, and I think that. As I understand it, and then you could help clarify, is that we would just be yet another one of your roster of folks that are embracing this platform. If there came a time for whatever reason that we needed to give back the stuff or something, I imagine that there wouldn't be any harm or penalty to say, nope, okay, thanks, we're all done, here you go.
Yep.
Something to that effect, so I'm sure we could tighten all that stuff up as needed. But, when I think about, if this is the carrot, I don't really hear a big stick either for it, too. So. I'm about done with those puns now.
No, that's great, Councilman. I think, one other part of our resume is we were just honored by the governor of Michigan 2 weeks ago, or beginning of this month, or May 7th, that we were, top 50 company to watch in Michigan for 2015. So this is something that we're really excited about. We're honored that the governor saw our vision in this product. And last year, I developed this product with the help of the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program in Detroit. And so I took part in that, and I got to meet, the big guys, including Warren Buffett, in September, which was great. So we have a really great plan. And again, our nature of why we developed this was really to help out people and to get them active. So we want to reward people for being active, not reward people for buying things and stuff. It's try to lose some weight or be a little bit more active, and then you should be rewarded for it.
One last question, if I may. Thank you, sir. In terms of timing, if we did choose to proceed, what kind of ramp-up phase, or how does all that work?
It takes about a half a day to install 5 beacons. Mm-hmm. You can probably do it in 30 minutes, but if you have to get a ladder or something like that.
Show them the device, what it looks like.
We just use this one. This one's where you can, this goes down to minus 40 degrees F and up to 120 degrees F. So this one will work outside, but it doesn't take much to install it.
That could happen in the same week.
Yeah, right. Very good. Councilor Blanchard.
Thank you, Your Honor. Well, my major concern here is the fact that I got this information on Friday night. And as you know, if you were on Saturday, it rained all day Saturday, and it rained all day Sunday, so I didn't get to talk to any residents or any people until today. And in talking to some business people and talking to some residents, I did not, unfortunately, get a very positive reception. the comment that I received from some residents was, what, another, somebody else pushing ads at us, okay? I explained what it was. In business context was the cost. Our businesses in this town are small. $2 a day is, you know, doesn't seem like a lot, but there's other advertising they do also. So that was my one concern. I didn't have enough time to, this also has not been taken to the Chamber of Commerce yet, which I would think would be your first place to go, because I'm the liaison to the Chamber and I've not seen anything about it there. My other concern is the Berkley deliverables. Here are the things that you want us to do. Promote the use of the CARET program through normal promotional and communication methods. This will include websites, social media pages, Facebook, Twitter, email, et cetera, print advertising, radio and television advertising, signage, banners, posters, newsletters, email blasts, and any other communication programs. Most of that we don't do. We can't afford it. We don't do radio ads. We don't do TV ads. That's a big wish list. I wish we were big enough to be able to afford to do that, but we don't. Issue a press release announcing Berkeley's Youth the CARET program. Yeah, that's an easy one. Provide a letter of endorsement and a list of all Berkeley's businesses with contact information. So you want us to provide you the names of all the businesses and all the people and their phone numbers.
Yeah, that's what we have here, but we can also get that from the Chamber.
And encourage downloads of CARET apps at local events and through above-mentioned communications. My concern is this. For me, this is a little fast. As a lot of people on the council know, I dig into things quite deeply, and I didn't have much time to dig, so I'm still a little concerned about not the app itself, the benefit to the city, what the city's going to get for it. Well, I know we're going to get data. I don't know that we know how to use the data, and I don't know if we will use the data. But I think your idea of the fitness, your idea of the businesses, as far as I'm concerned, that's up to the business. That sounds like a fairly good thing to me. My concern is the cities. Now, what other cities have signed up as a partner with you?
So Royal Oak was our first. We're actually beaconing up Allen Park tomorrow. So that's one. Pontiac is another one that's hopped on. We've also talked to Birmingham. They're very optimistic and really really excited about having gain all this analytics in their city. And then we also had the last one would been Wyandotte is another one. And we haven't put that in here, but Trenton is on our list that we're going to talk to just through Allen Park.
My basic concern is a little fast for me to look at this stuff, but I've looked at the format for the data and don't understand it at all. So, okay.
Good. Councilmember Stedman.
I was just wondering if Mr. Lisco had taken a look at it.
I have read the information, yes.
Do you understand?
Yes, and I endorse it.
Can you come up to you want to come up to the mic and just...
Yes, I have read the information just in your packet, and I have met with Jane regarding the app. I think it's a good idea. I think the app, though, is contingent on people downloading it because the data is only those people that use it. So the data is very valuable, but it won't be valuable at first because it's going to take some time for the app to be downloaded, and businesses are going to have to buy into the program, too.
Mm-hmm.
But I wholeheartedly endorse it, yeah.
What if businesses don't buy into the program? What happens then?
The data isn't very useful. Well, it's as simple as that.
Yeah. From our point of view.
Yes, from our point of view, yes.
Yeah. We would still have data from our beacon, say, if we had City
Correct.
Hall.
Exactly,
Parks
yes.
and Rec and
as
the library
the government,
and wherever
yes, as far as for City
right,
Hall and our
right,
own.
Right.
But, I mean, I could see it as far as the DDA and the Chamber of Commerce, as far as the foot traffic and seeing... foot traffic patterns, you know how we have traffic patterns as far as the road commission and things like that. I think it would be very useful as far as to target specific areas of the downtown. I think it would be very, very useful.
I don't know if you can answer this or not. It says on this little informational sheet here, 1 year is this amount with 10% off and includes blah, 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 blah. That's not $2 a day. That's far less.
It's up to $2 a day. Yes, thank you. I say typically it's $2 a day, but it could be less than $2 a day when you order in bulk, right, for 12 months. It's for the case for the first year, it's truly about a little over $2 a day. It's $720.
Right.
Or just under. It's actually just under. It says 365 days. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so just under $2 a day. In the second year, it's going to be $600 minus 10% off. So it's really $540, not $640. That was a mistype there. Mm-hmm. So that's definitely less than $2 a day.
I have another question. Okay, this is just from my understanding here. People have to walk by with, is it any particular kind of phone?
It's made for iPhone and Android, so you're looking at 95% of the market now.
Okay, all right. You have to walk by within 200 feet of that beacon to get the information from that, like the police station, the city hall, the library, some store downtown or whatever. But we can send emails out to within a 1 mile radius of somebody who has walked by.
So what we did with Zumbas is we sent essentially was a text message to anybody that was within a mile of Zumbas. To if you were to show up in the first hour, then you would get $5 off of the burrito.
How were you able to send them out to anybody within the first mile?
Now we're not using that feature for Carrot right here. All we're doing right now is, if you're traveling less than 45 miles an hour in a car, then we'll shoot you a message. We're not advising everybody to look at their phones while driving, but it will show up in their history and that they went by these number of stores and these are all the different deals that you mm-hmm. drove by. But if you are walking within 200 feet of any store, mm-hmm. you get a message that makes sense to you as an individual. Like you, as a female, you would get something different than what I would get.
Okay.
Very good. Councilman Kadek.
Thank you, Your Honor. I think the idea and the concept's a great idea, but I do concur with Councilmember Blanchard in the fact that sometimes you have TMI, too much information, not enough information, and I'm not saying from your standpoint, from the reaction, maybe if you go to the chamber and speak with them because they have a chamber chat the third Friday of every month, you can reach a lot of the businesses that way or talk to the chamber executive director. I think rather than rush into the vote, I would be more comfortable having them come back with some more information, with us coming back with more information at the next meeting, let's say. And then, I mean, it gives us a 2-week window, not a 2-day window, to go out there and find some information. So I wouldn't be adverse to, you know, holding off on this.
Okay. Now, what we're talking about specifically here is about the city's involvement.
Yeah.
Correct.
And that's
just
it.
Just the city.
Not the businesses.
That's
whether
correct.
The business, that's your worry to sell this product to the businesses.
Correct.
We are obliged to make a decision on behalf of the city. See, so it's very different. Councilman Redgar.
And our attorney would work out the verbiage so that it would be with you, right? I'm just clarifying.
I would expect to if this moves forward, yes.
Okay. Because there are things in there that are iffy and confusing and need to be clarified.
Okay. So we're at a situation now where we generally understand what is taking place here. This application has the capacity to help us develop some data mm-hmm. and push out some city messages. Mm-hmm. If you, in the process, are able to encourage businesses to participate in that, so much the better.
Correct.
It does advance the tech-savvy feature that is fairly strong in this city. And so, therefore, I expect a lot of people to actually have this on their iPhone pretty quickly. And it encourages healthy behavior, rewards fundamentally healthy behavior for customers who want to use it in that way. We have a couple more questions. Councilman Stedman.
Oh, I was just going to say the only problem with waiting, I'm not sure how long it'll take to happen. I don't see there's really any risk to this.
That's what I
and I don't see any. I don't see. The problem I see with waiting is we have some major events coming up.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
through the summer.
Be nice to have this
summer. It would be nice to get this.
Yes.
So you're thinking things like Art Bash coming right away now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you're saying you can have those things up in a matter of a few hours.
Yes, we're going to do Allen Park between 9 and 11 tomorrow.
Okay. Yeah. Councilor Blanchard, another.
I just have a quick question, basically for maybe the attorney or city manager. A little while ago, we talked about a job fair that was coming, and we tried. I mentioned we got to get some publicity for that because people in our city are looking for jobs. And I was told that we couldn't do that because it's a for-profit company. We couldn't talk about them on our website. And here we have, I assume, a for-profit company that's asking us to put stuff on our website about them. What's the difference?
Well, I think one difference is that we would come up with some sort of agreement with them, which is a little bit different, I think. That's just my first take on it. Something that we, the city, are looking to do ourselves, which then this is part of us. So in that respect, I kind of see it in that fashion. Mr. Attorney?
Well, I think that's a fair comment. There is nothing that prevents, from a legal standpoint, there's nothing that prevents the city from utilizing its website in various ways, including even some limited advertising and so on. That's a policy choice that we make as opposed to something that we're not legally permitted to do. In this particular case, what we would be doing is, as we said before, it'd be a contractual relationship where there's quid pro quo. We are getting something, presumably of value, to the city, and just as we do with every vendor, we pay for the services we receive. In this particular case, the payment would be more of a promotional type of consideration on website and social media as opposed to cash, you know, writing a check and scratching it out. So, I mean, it's doable from a legal standpoint. I think it's just a matter of whether council determines this is the right thing or not for the city to get involved with.
Mr. Stern, I'm on, you know, on our website right now, for example, we have Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Pinterest. Those are all on our website. I don't see, and they're certainly for profit as far as I know. I don't see, you know, if we put a carrot up there as well or in that, I don't see that being any different than what we're doing right now with those. Now, if we're, you know, going to devote the whole homepage to it, that could be, you know, a different situation. But, you know, we already have, you know, at least five for-profit companies on there already.
I think that's right, and certainly I would expect there would be some limitations. The city, for instance, probably doesn't want pop-up ads on its website and any, you know, direct promotions or advertisements right on the website, you know, $5 off, you know, today only at your friendly neighborhood car wash or something like that, but rather would be more of probably more of a link for people to, you know,
download the app.
As you said, similar to these other types of apps that are already accessible from our website.
Okay, thank you.
Councilmember Stedman.
So the advertising for that comes through our little boxes that we have at our various buildings. Yeah. That would only be our advertising, though, right?
So when you're in front of the library, I think this was, one idea that the mayor was just talking about with a public library message. For instance, you can get with 10,000 steps, you can get a dollar reduced from your book late fee, right? Something like that. So that they can now, if you have a book that's late, just walk a little bit more, and then you'll be able to get a dollar off.
But the city would set those. She's asking this, so we set them. It's not, yeah, somebody can't anywhere around set
right.
it
That's
and
correct.
Zip
it's
it.
Only
if
for
I pass
you.
The library and somewhere
we,
else,
I go into
go
my little carrot
stuff.
App okay. and look, and I see, oh, here at the library, this is what they're advertising. And then there's another link there that says O'Mara's is advertising something else. But that wouldn't come through.
It only shows up when you're in front of O'Meara's. Right. Correct.
So we don't by doing this, we are not providing their advertising.
Correct.
Right.
Okay.
Absolutely. Councilmember Pig.
Thank you. And Councilman Blanchard, I want to thank you and the rest of us for these good questions, right? I mean, it really does show the care with which we want to move forward or consider things like that. So I really do celebrate this dialogue. This is great. And to that point about the advertising, the link or whatever, that is almost completely self-serving in the sense that we want people to download the app so that we can get better data.
Right.
Right? And if it so happens that when they walk by O'Mara's, they get a discount, and when they walk by the haircut place, they get a free whatever. That's up to them and the businesses. We want them to download the app so that we can get better data, so that we can provide better services and better products and better events and things mm-hmm. like that on behalf of the residents.
Correct.
So it's in that sense, because there's no cost to the resident to download the app, no cost for them to use it. So it's in that sense, it's really promoting the city by putting that link there, because we in turn can help make things even better.
Very good. We need to move along now. Councilman
The Kadeckel. Berkley deliverables, those are flexible. You could work on those, correct?
Those are flexible. This is kind of
a standard.
Standard.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm comfortable with that.
Comfortable.
Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor, I would just like to say that based on some of the comments today, I'd like to work with the city attorney to perhaps address some of the concerns that the city council may have, and we can look at this and maybe clarify a few of the concerns that the city council has, especially when it comes to some of the deliverables. Mm-hmm. That would be something that I'd like to address carefully, concerns regarding liability or whatever, things of that nature.
Sure.
I could talk to the attorney and make sure that we have the proper language.
Sure.
Discussions regarding should we wish to terminate this agreement, because I don't think there's anything in there as well, to make sure that we can do it. Term, all that kind of stuff. I know that they're just starting and that they're new, and this is why they wanted to promote this quickly. But it's certainly something that the city attorney and I could work with.
Okay, well, I'm particularly encouraged that our number one tech expert is basically saying, I've looked at this. This makes sense, and that's important.
That's
important
to
us. Oh, no, it's not me. Very good. So are we comfortable now saying that if we pass this, we're going to pass this and turn it over to the manager and attorney to do the fine-tuning? Does it need to come back again to us? Let's talk about this for a second. Jack. Okay, Councilman Blanchard.
Yes, it does need to come back to us. We need to see what the agreement is that's going to be signed. I mean, these are nice marketing tools. They're good. They've done a good job with the marketing tools.
Yeah.
But we're interested in the liability of the city, the legal agreement, what the legal agreement is going to look like, and I want John to say, I've read this. It makes sense to me. I'm all for it.
Okay. Is that the sense then? Any agreement dissenting voices on that view?
Why can't we do that through email?
Why can't we do that through email? Is
a little thing called the Open Meetings Act.
Yeah.
That's why.
That's what I was waiting for.
Yeah.
Councilor Kadeckel.
Yeah, I agree with that. You know what? I don't remember ever voting for a contract without knowing the exact wording on it since I've been here.
Ms. DeSessa, we have a meeting in 2 weeks.
Yes.
The next
yes.
meeting.
We could bring it at the next meeting for the council.
Okay.
Is that before Art Bash?
It'll be after Art Bash.
Yeah,
but
it'll be after.
I mean, if it is,
may
it is.
Miss out on that one
it's
event,
okay.
But
it'll be ready for other things. That's
the
not
one.
The issue. We don't have to hurry things either.
That's
things
right.
have to be right.
Yeah.
So then the proposal is that it will return back to city manager, city attorney to work out all the details and bring us back this item again on the 18th,
very good.
And it looks like, all things considered, it seems like a promising situation if I'm to judge
Absolutely.
The general tone of the discussion.
Sounds very fair. Thank you for your time.
Very good. Then that is, Councilman.
I'm sorry, Mr. Mayor, but don't we have a motion on the
we
floor
do.
To approve this or not approve
we're
it?
Going to, we're going
so
to
do we
now.
Need an amendment
we're going to amend it. And that's what I'm going to look for.
Okay.
Is somebody to amend this motion that will say that it returns back to staff, and then we'll come back to council.
As the maker of the motion, I'd be glad to do just that, to offer that it comes back after the fine-tuning and tweaking and all those kinds of things.
I'll support that.
Supported by the Mayor Pro Tem. Very good. Very good. Everybody's in agreement on this then?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Very good. We'll have a quick vote on the amendment first, just to make sure.
Okay. Terbrick?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
Blanchard?
Yes.
Edgar?
Yes.
Kadeckel?
Yes.
Stedman?
Yes.
O'Dwyer?
Yes. And now for the main motion, call the roll, please.
Baker?
Yes.
Blanchard?
Yes.
Edgar?
Yes.
Kadeckel?
Yes.
Stedman?
Yes.
Terbrick?
Yes.
O'Dwyer?
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you all for the discussion. Thank you for
being
here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
See you in 2 weeks.
Sounds like an interesting and good development for us. And now, Ms. Vecchio, would you please read item number 6?
Motion number M3415, matter of approving the Berkley Junior Women's Club event, Robina Rhapsody, on Robina from 12 Mile to the alley north of 12 Mile Road on Thursday, June 18th, July 16th, August 20th, and September 17th from 5 p.m. till 9:30 p.m.
Is there a motion to approve M3415?
Motion to approve.
Motion approved by Councilmember Edgar.
Support.
Support by Councilmember Kadeckel. Mr. Sessa.
Council, I'm very proud to bring this item before you. It's something that you address on an annual basis. We do have with us Ms. Denise Brainerd from the Women's Club, who can come in and discuss this with you. Both Public Safety and Public Works have worked with them in the past, and they are recommending this for your consideration as well. So with that, I'll turn it over to Ms. Brainerd. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Once again, I am coming to you wearing my Berkley Junior Women's Club hat to ask for permission for us, along with the DDA, to be able to host the Robina Rhapsody. As you all know, Robina Rhapsody is a summer concert series. It's free to the public. It's the third Thursday of the month in June, July, August, and we're hoping to be able to do one in September as well. We shut down the street, we have the music, we've tentatively got the schedule set up for June 18th. We're going to have Madigan's Attic. On July 16th, it's going to be the Aaron Vaughn Band's last Berkley performance. August 20th, we've got a group called the Aspersions, which I'm really excited about. They've got it's going to help us continue with the Dream Cruise theme. And then I'm hoping for our September concert to be able to have representatives from the Detroit Institute of Music Education. If you were at Berkley Days, they came and played on the Saturday of Berkley Days. Don't want to mention the band yet because I haven't confirmed that we're going to have them, but I'm trying very hard to get that same group that was here for Berkley Days. So I'm very excited about it. Like I said, it's a free event. Everybody is welcome to come up there, bring your lawn chair. We've got bubbles and hula hoops and chalk for the kids, things for the kids to play with. These bands, I've heard them. They're all phenomenal. It's all going to be music that we all know. People are welcome to come and dance. It's a wonderful event. It's one of those things that just makes me love living in Berkley because we can do things like this. So would like to ask your permission. One thing I would like to, we had set it for the third Thursday in September as well, which is September 17th. That's starting to get a little late in the year. School is back in session. So I would like, with your permission, to have the option of maybe doing it on September 10th a little earlier, where it stays later, lighter, a little bit later. It's going to be the first week back to school. We can kind of use that as a back to school fun thing for the kids. We also won't be going as late that night because we are going back to school then. So I would like to do it on the 10th in September instead of the 17th, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? It's a wonderful event.
That was easy.
It is. It is, because it's such a fun event and such a community event. And its location is a kind of a central location as well.
Everyone can walk there.
Everybody can walk there, get points on their carrot This is just no end to the adventures. So then we will make that adjustment September 10th.
Thank you,
instead
Mr. Mayor.
Of the 17th. Ms. Vecchia, would you please call the roll on M3415?
Blanchard.
Yes.
Edgar.
Yes.
Kadeckel.
Yes.
Stedman.
Yes.
Terbrick.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. Thank you, Denise.
Thank you very much.
And now, Ms. Vecchia, would you please read item number 7?
Ordinance number 0215, matter of considering the first reading of an ordinance to rezone property described as the north 40 feet of lot 148 of the cottage home subdivision from parking district P1 to single family residential district R1D. Set dates are in June 15th, 2015.
Is there a motion to approve 0215, setting a date certain of June 15th?
Move to approve.
Support.
Move to approve by Councilmember Kadeckel, support by Councilmember Edgar. Ms. DeSessa.
Council, I will ask our city planner, Ms. Amy Vansom, to come up and give us a brief overview on this item. I'm also pleased to report, as you can see, our chair is with us as well from the Planning Commission. So, David, if you don't mind assisting where needed, perhaps, I would appreciate it. But just so that everybody knows, the Planning Commission did hold a public hearing on May 26th on this matter, and then Ms. Vanson will now give us a description of where we are now. Ms. Vanson.
Planning Commission held a public hearing. Everybody within 300 feet was notified. That's in accordance with state and local law, and we published a notice in the newspaper as well. Planning Commission is required to hold a public hearing and make findings of fact and a recommendation to the City Council. They're required to look at the existing uses of the property within the general area of the property in question, the zoning classification of the property within the general area of the property in question, the suitability of the property to the uses permitted under the existing zoning classification, the trend of development in the general area, including any changes that have taken place, and the objectives of the current land use plan for the City of Berkeley. Now, this is, since we started keeping track in 1994 of rezonings, this is the first time we've ever had somebody asking to have something zoned parking back to single family. Ms. Hartfield is here, but she did approach the city last year about wanting to redevelop some parts of Hartfield. Owns quite a bit of land, and she was looking at a couple of different options, one on Royal that was going to involve re-engineering and rebuilding a cul-de-sac. This property is on Buckingham. It actually had a house on it prior to 1969 and was demolished and developed as a parking lot in 1969. It has been unused as a parking lot since, I think you said, 12 years. It's not needed, and the thought is that new single-family home in the city would be better than an unused parking lot. Now, the Planning Commission did talk about wanting to have a crystal ball and being able to see what would happen in this block and whether parking, which is not needed right now for the uses that are there, what would happen if? And of course, that's always, hindsight's always 20/20, right? But the applicant did approach the city, did approach the DDA. It only holds 10 cars. I don't think it was considered large enough or in an area that really needed it. And as I say in my report, parking's really a chicken and egg thing. You don't want to have too much of it, and then suddenly you need it. So, but Ms. Hartfield did talk to the abutting businesses, is what she told the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission there held the public hearing. There were no comments at that time. And so the Planning Commission did recommend approval of the rezoning to City Council.
Very good. Are there questions for Ms. Vanson? This is an unusual request that we are turning a parking area into a house when this is a controversial matter. Councilmember Kadeckel.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I walked by the site today, visited the area, and it's just a bunch of cement with weeds growing on it, and I think it'd look much nicer with a house on there, and I'm very confident that the Hartfields will do the right thing.
Mm-hmm. Any other discussion?
I visited also good crop of weeds. That's all. That's all there.
I drove by today as well.
One of the conclusions we draw from this, Ms. Vanson, the council does its due diligence. They drive by the properties.
Absolutely. That's what you have to do.
I walked.
Oh, they walked.
Should have had your carrot.
More carrot points.
Oh, my. The running gag throughout the night.
That's right.
I think it counts runs, too.
Yeah, it does. So this seems to me to be a pretty obvious kind of decision for us to make. And if there aren't any more points to be made here, then Ms. Vecchia, would you please call the roll on 00215?
Edgar.
Yes.
Kadeckel.
Yes.
Stedman.
Yes.
Terbrek.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
Blanchard.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. And now, Ms. Vecchia, would you please read item number 8?
Motion number M3515, matter of authorizing the Planning Commission to distribute the master plan amendment pertaining to residential housing types to surrounding communities and underlying agencies for comment in accordance with the Municipal Planning Act.
Is there a motion to approve M3515?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve by Councilmember Edgar with support by Councilmember Stedman. Ms. DeSessa.
Council, I'm really pleased with and very thankful to the Planning Commission for their work regarding this matter. As I mentioned earlier, our Planning Commissioner, our Chair, Mr. David Barnett is here with us as well. He can address any questions you may have. But also thank Ms. Vanson for all her hard work on this matter as well. It's very good. And I'm hoping that, again, this is just the first step, Your Honor. We still have to come back. But I am recommending that the City Council consider this favorably. And I'll ask our City Planner, Ms. Vanson, to explain to the public what we're doing here.
Sure.
Ms. Vanson.
The Municipal Planning Act states that the Planning Commission is required to develop a master plan that guides development, and that any changes in zoning ordinances or zoning maps need to be in compliance with that master plan. The process that the Municipal Planning Act sets up is that so that communities don't act just on their own accord, that you have to notify the surrounding communities, underlying agencies such as districts, utility companies, railroads, if we had one, that sort of thing, as well as the county. And so I have notified those agencies, advising them that we are looking at updating our master plan with this amendment. We followed the same procedure when we adopted the transit-oriented development study as well as the multimodal transportation plan. So, as you know, the City Council, because you were all the City Council when you did this, approved the budget for a form-based code, and we had talked about developing a form-based code for residential design standards, housing standards, and so forth. And we are in the midst of doing that. The Planning Commission's working with LSL Planning, as you know, and moving toward that end. We've had some favorable meetings with developers because, again, it's one thing if you zone it or allow for it. As we found with Greenfield and 12 Mile, we do allow townhouses and multiple family, and we've had that done since 2007, and we don't have anybody knocking on our door to do that sort of development. So we wanted to have meetings with developers to see if this was even worth going through this exercise. Those meetings were favorable, and so the Planning Commission said, yes, let's go ahead. Our current master plan says that all of the single-family residential districts should remain single-family districts. It also noted that the housing stock is not very diverse. We have a lot of single-family detached, not a lot of alternative housing, whether it's apartments, townhouses, that sort of thing. More in line with what Huntington Woods has versus Royal Oak or Ferndale. The master plan did say townhouses would be a good idea. It stopped short of saying where we ought to put them. And since 2007, the Planning Commission has really been struggling to find a spot because once you zone something for townhouses, then you're if you really want to have that happen, you're throwing everybody that's there into nonconformity, and that makes insurance companies a little nervous. So the Planning Commission's been struggling with this. So with the form-based code, this was considered a possible solution to allow these alternative housing types within the single-family residential districts, but have them make sense.
But we've got to amend the master plan to say that, to say that we want to do that. And so before you is a draft amendment to the master plan. I wrote it, essentially says all of these things. And we've done the work of it. It was a matter of putting it on paper and saying, you know, this is how Berkley developed. This is the kind of housing types we have. This is the population trend. These are the kind of households we have and why we need different kind of housing for the growing, the population that is going to be here in the next 30 years. Mm-hmm. So, and the recommendations are outlined. Planning Commission reviewed this. They did want to have a little more articulation on the definition of streets as far as local streets, collector streets, and major thoroughfares, which should the form-based code continue to be developed and be recommended for City Council, you would see that that will play a part in where housing types would be allowed. So that was considered important to define that. So nothing's being adopted this evening. It's really you guys giving the okay, you guys, the council. Sorry, it's late. apologize. You all giving the okay to, it's a little better, isn't it? To distribute the plan so that the underlying agencies, surrounding communities, and the county can comment on it. They have 63 days under state law to do that. And after that time, the Planning Commission could publicize a public hearing and adopt it if they decided to.
Very good. I like the forward progressive thinking that's reflected in the document. I hear from a lot of people in town as the years go by, they would like to be living in a townhouse rather than their single family home.
Yeah.
Because they love this community, they're passionate about Berkley, and they don't want to be moving.
Right.
So I from a marketing point of view, I think there'd be a terrific market for townhouses, condos, and that kind of thing that would preclude cutting lawns and shoveling snow and such matters, and yet allow people to be able to walk through our lovely downtown and be with the community that they have lived in for so many years. So I really like this. Comments from the council?
Just a general statement in support as well. I also know very little about form-based codes, but as I understand to differentiate that from the more conventional methods, I do think this really does help advance not only the kinds of things that we can do here, but gives us that additional flexibility. So, yeah, I'm fully supportive of it as well.
Thank you.
Very good. Seeing no other discussion then,
okay.
Thank you, Ms. Fenson, for your work on this. This is significant work.
Yes.
From the Planning Commission and yourself. Good job.
Thank you.
Ms. Vecchio, would you please call the roll on M3515?
Kadeckel.
Yes.
Stedman.
Yes.
Terbrek.
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
Blanchard?
Yes.
Edgar?
Yes.
O'Dwyer?
Yes. And now, Ms. Vecchio, number 9, please.
Motion number M3615, matter of endorsing the Woodward Avenue Complete Streets cross-section with the changes as stipulated by the City Planning Commission.
Is there a motion to approve M3615?
Move to approve.
Move to approve by Councilmember Kadeckel with support by Councilmember Stedman. Mr. Sessa.
Council, when I received this report a couple of weeks ago, both Ms. Vanson and I, we work with Woodward Avenue Action Association as they go through this process. But I thought it was important that that she present this to the Planning Commission for their comment, and then, of course, bring this back to the City Council so that you can see exactly what's going up. And so with that, I've asked Ms. Vanson to put this presentation together and solicit input from the City Council. And again, I know it's her recommendation, mine, that the City Council favorably also consider the recommendation made by the Planning Commission. Again, if you have any questions, Ms. Manson and I will be happy to answer, but she does have a presentation prepared for you. One more? What do I have to do? Yeah. Oops. Oops. One more light.
Okay, so I'm going to try and do justice to this. In 2010, the state of Michigan adopted what's known as Complete Streets legislation, which many of you know what it is. For the folks at home, A complete street is a street that allows all modes. That means pedestrians, bicyclists, cars, buses, streetcars. It allows all those modes. It also allows pedestrians, regardless of their ability or their age, to be able to use and cross the street safely. So it's a street that you can cross without having to jog across it and be able to safely cross. So that was adopted in 2010. You may remember that right around 2012 or so, the Berkley, along with its Woodward neighbors, was looking at doing phase two of an alternative analysis. This is when M1 rail was going in, but then there was also going to be a BRT or a streetcar that was going to go along Woodward. And all of that was happening during Detroit going into bankruptcy. And so SEMCOG said, and the Department of Transportation, Federal Department of Transportation, said, hold on, we want to look at all of Woodward from Detroit to Pontiac and look at it comprehensively. And we now have a regional transit authority, and that's composed of all of the counties as well as Detroit. And so that process began at about the same time. MDOT, and Woodward is MDOT's, and the WA3, the Woodward Avenue Action Association, started working on a request for proposal because they wanted to develop a plan for a complete street for Woodward. That got put on hold while the rapid transit for Woodward was being worked on. The locally preferred alternatives then handed off to the Regional Transit Authority. They actually had a series of public meetings a couple weeks ago in June. But the complete streets is back. And so I say all of that because I know there, when we get to the individual cross sections, there was some discussion about where the BRT is shown. And this particular project assumes that they had to make some assumptions. And so they did the locally preferred alternative that was approved last year. It may change. It may move depending upon funding or what the environmental assessment says or what have you. But at this point, this project isn't about where the BRT is at. It's about all the stuff in between. And so, let's see. So we did 2013. Okay, so this is back. They presented this, the folks at Parsons Brinkerhoff, who have the task of fitting all of these modes into Woodward. Depending upon how wide Woodward is, it gets quite narrow, especially in Highland Park, and gets very wide outside of Highland Park between 6 Mile and 8 Mile. They've had the task of trying to put all of these modes together in a very pleasing way. And so in April, this was presented to the committee, and Berkley was essentially, and I'm just gonna skip over this, if you have questions about, this is downtown, this is Detroit, this would essentially be Highland Park and Detroit, where it's very narrow. This is between 6 Mile and 8 Mile, a lot of room. This is Ferndale, Pleasant Ridge, essentially. There are streets, but we'll just simplify it for the purposes. This would be Huntington Woods, I-696 to 11 Mile. And then this was considered, this was proposed for 11 Mile to 14 Mile. Now, 2 points that matter is the bollards that are shown would not be there. It would be either a curb, a big curb, so that the cars can't go over and hit the bicyclists, or as an alternative, it's the door zone, which is the white stripes to allow for people to open their car doors, and the bike lane would all be at sidewalk level. So those were two options, not the bollards. Also, point of clarification, you'll notice the bike lane is only a one-way bike lane, and that caused some concern on the part of the Planning Commission as well, because if you wanted to bike up and down Woodward, you would have to cross Woodward, and that could get a little dicey. So in this section, the service drive is gone, or in this proposal, the service drives in Berkley would be replaced by parallel parking, the door zone, a bike lane, and then a very large sidewalk. At this April meeting, I expressed some concern about this. The folks at MDOT and Parsons Brinkerhoff said, well, how about this one? Instead, this one keeps the service drive. Huntington Woods and myself, we both have some concerns about that area. That it looks so pretty with the pretty plants between Woodward and the bike lane, but I just don't think it's ever going to look that pretty. So that's my concern, is because it's not right next to a business, maintenance concerns. This is actually adopted from, this is taken from Birmingham. This is what they have adopted already as part of their Woodward plan. So the service drive would stay. The bike lane is just inside the service drive, and so it's pretty self-explanatory. The folks in Royal Oak and Pleasant Ridge thought this was a pretty good idea. At this meeting, the MDOT folks certainly want to simplify things and not have too many cross sections to deal with. So their thought was, well, hey, Berkley, what do you think about this? Or hey, Huntington Woods, what do you think about this? And I said, I've got to take it back to my people. So you are my people. And so we talked to the Planning Commission about this, and the Planning Commission, being your really good planning commission, looked at this option and this option and said, well, how about a third option? Because we don't like either one of these, really. So I'll get to that in a second. I did talk to Public Safety about this, as well as Public Works. And this is in your report. Public Safety was concerned about this as far as the, obviously, Woodward moves pretty fast. The whole intent of this is to slow Woodward down. We can argue whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, but that is the intent of this. Parallel parking on Woodward, maybe a little bit dicey. You might have some fender benders with this scenario. I don't know what the parking differences are going to be. That level of analysis hasn't been done, whether this will result in fewer. The folks at Parsons Brinkerhoff didn't think so. I can't answer that. I don't know. Public Safety was concerned about fender benders here. Certainly, the bike lane being at street grade with a curb in between it would cause, it wasn't considered optimal. Public Works was concerned about, with a curb that and the bike lane being at street grade, separated by two curbs, that it's just going to collect trash. And it's going to be a real, it's just going to be an eyesore very quickly. Also, the snow is going to pile up there in the wintertime, and it's going to be difficult to shovel it since it's just that wide. If it was at sidewalk grade, certainly that would afford the pedestrians more use. If the bicycle lane's not being used, you would have a greater, you'd have a roomier sidewalk. But there might be the potential for bicyclist and pedestrian conflict. With this option, Public Safety was very, 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 very concerned about bicyclists. If a car is turning into the service drive from Woodward, they are not going to be looking for a bicyclist back behind them at the 8 o'clock mark or 5 o'clock mark. That was really considered most dangerous, and certainly a fender bender with parallel parking is bad, but everybody's in a car. And this one, car versus bicyclist, the bicyclist is going to lose. So this was considered very, very dangerous for bicyclists. So that's why the Planning Commission thought of a different option. This would be in Bloomfield Hills, Bloomfield Township. This is Pontiac. So this is what the Planning Commission came up with, and let's see if I remember how to do this pointer that Stan told me how to use. It would be, we'd keep the service drive, but this says raise bike lane and door zone level with sidewalk, and then move it over here between the parked cars, the parallel parking, put a wide bike lane and a door zone, and so essentially the parked cars would scooch over a little bit. They'd be more over here. There'd still be room for the cars to drive. It wouldn't be blocked or anything like that, but this area would move over. Does that make sense? If you have questions, please let me know. So that's what the Planning Commission has recommended. You can see in my report, it was not a unanimous recommendation. Commissioner Richardson felt that this option calmed traffic better and was a more complete street. Maintenance would be less of an issue since it would all be adjoining the business, and that area would be probably swept more frequently. Commissioner Morrell thought that having the bicyclists in either option up at sidewalk level was going to cause a lot of bicyclist pedestrian problems, and that bicyclists tend to be rather cavalier with a lot of traffic laws and sometimes only stop when their life is in danger and don't generally follow things. And so he saw that bringing them up to pedestrian level was problematic. So it wasn't unanimous, but a majority did recommend that option to you. Now, WA3, certainly, while this is MDOT's road, and I should say, I think City Council understands this, but I will let anybody watching know, there's no funding for any of this. This is a 10-year plan. When it is adopted by the WA3 and MDOT. But there is no imminent funding for this. None of that's going to happen anytime soon. Certainly, we've got a lot of other issues to worry about with our roads rather than doing this. But the idea is that it would be a 10-year plan. MDOT certainly understands that this is their road. But they do want to have buy-in from all of the communities, and certainly it won't happen, politically speaking, if there's folks don't want it. So they're looking at communities to endorse it, and so we have a hybrid option that was endorsed. Debbie Schutt from the WA3, the executive director, and the one that kind of started Woodward way back when in the late 90s, all of the Woodward Corridor plans. She was there, and so were the two designers and engineers at Parsons Brinkerhoff, so they are aware of what the Planning Commission has recommended. And I think that's it, unless you see something in my report that I didn't call attention to, but I think I've covered it. Do you have any questions?
Thank you. Very, very thorough presentation.
Hopefully not too long-winded.
Of a vision.
A vision, yes.
You know, yeah. That's the way it seems to me. Are there any questions for Ms. Svensson? Any discussion on this matter? Councilmember Baker.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. Thank you for all your great work. Thank you to the Commission for their thoughtful consideration of this vision as well, and recognizing that a lot of the kinds of things that we'll talk about here are still obviously conceptual, and there's, like you said, a long 10-year plan that goes to this. So I don't know if we could bring some of those back up and just in the course of the dialogue here. I was wondering if you could, again, help me understand the proposal before us, the hybrid option here.
Yes.
I know I'm missing something, because to me, if we make the changes as suggested, move the bike lane over, put the door zone in there, and raise it up to grade, how is that different than the 11 to 14 mile one? I'm missing that piece, because it sounds a lot like it.
Because there's a service drive that's going to make parallel parking easier.
So we have less sidewalk, we have more vehicle.
Well, you have sidewalks split between two areas, don't you?
Yeah.
But the idea was that this was safer for parallel parking.
Okay. Yeah, so good. So that was it. So there's still more of the service drive, less of the,
yes.
You know, and then it's a split sidewalk in that sense.
Yeah.
Okay. I can certainly understand some of the minority report in the thinking around that, because it's, you know, it's the fun thing about hybrids is it's sort of a combination of two things trying to solve a greater whole and things like
right.
that. So I think
win, yeah.
Yeah, that kind of stuff.
To,
so,
yeah.
So I applaud the creativity. How about that? in the hybrid and seeking to try to find a good fit. But having said all of that, I do, you know, have a little bit of exposure to some of the complete streets work from back in the day, and of course the transit items, and I was satisfied with the 11 to 14 as well. So I may lean that way tonight in my thinking.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good. Yeah, question, Your Honor. Who owns the service drive? Is that MDOT own that?
MDOT owns it.
Now when we. If we build this, who's going to maintain it?
Yeah.
That's the same question we got right
that,
now, right?
I brought that up. And, I brought that up, that the service drive, I had concerns about this because it's not going to look like that. And Jim Schultz from MDOT said, well, you know, you could do an assessments district to maintain that. You that could be solved. And I said, well, that's a political question. You know, one could argue, and I wasn't going to do it at that in that particular venue, but it's that it's theirs already, and maybe they should be doing it. But MDOT has, you know, they're about moving traffic. They're not about parking cars. And I know that MDOT, in meetings with them on the issue, on the service drive tweaks that they didn't tweak the service drives. They did the sidewalk ramps and so forth and some areas last year. There was discussion about the service drives. And the feeling on MDOT's part is, well, we're not in the parking business, and really we would rather just get rid of the service drives because it doesn't, it's not helpful to us. But I think it's left as a no man's land, and I think that's unfortunate.
One more question. Is there any serious consideration to doing brick like this shows? Because I think we've proven a while back that that's not
okay,
in our
well,
best interest.
I'm again going to say this was Birmingham's. This comes right out of Birmingham's master plan. And I don't know if that's just brickish-looking concrete. I'm sure it's not bricks. I'm sure
stamped
it's stamped
concrete.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what's wrong with bricks?
Make our feelings known on that, would you please?
Yes, I will.
Got something against pavers.
I'm just trying to clarify in my own mind what we're officially doing here tonight. So essentially, we had the two options, as you mentioned, the Planning Commission.
If three, really.
Their hybrid option, and that's the one that they have they've recommended to us. So we are voting just on their hybrid option, or are we choosing an option that we like here? Just so I know exactly what we are supposed to be officially voting on.
Well, I think the motion before you was to go ahead with what the Planning Commission recommended, if you wanted to change it, that would be within Council's authority.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. That's all I was looking for. Thank you.
And this is the proposed one by the Planning Commission?
This was the hybrid that they
the
came
version.
Trying to, yes, create a common ground that would ease public safety's concerns and keep the service drive so that there weren't fender benders, parallel parking.
That is the worry I have with the one out here on the 11 to 14, mm-hmm. is that parking and pulling in and pulling out, mm-hmm. With the traffic rolling along right beside it. I could see why that might be a more dangerous proposition.
Yeah.
I mean, there are places where that occurs.
Main Street. Yes.
Of course.
In Ferndale.
Yeah.
And on Coolidge.
Yeah.
Main Street.
Yeah.
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 Trying to solve that problem on Coolidge.
We're trying.
So, what is the will of the council here? Councilor Blanchard.
I think of the hybrid proposal is the best of all of them, I think, right now. I'd like to thank the Planning Commission. They put a lot of thought into this, and I think it's well thought out. And now this will go back into the pot and keep Parsons Brinkerhoff employed for another 2 years while I sort out this and make more of those drawings. So, you know, it's keeping people employed.
Well, we're for that too, I suppose. Councilmember Baker.
Thanks. Yeah, I agree that the intention behind what's described as the 11 to 14 is to do the very kinds of things that a complete street is meant to do, which is to calm the traffic and to make us aware. And it's hard to imagine, so we've talked earlier about thinking about the future and the progressive way that we want to advance, not in the coming years, but in the coming decades. And mm-hmm. and so it's hard to see something that's pretty different, and we can imagine it through today's lenses, right? Mm-hmm. Imagining 10 years from now, how once this is in place, the benefits that it has to offer. And we can see that in many other communities that have made these kinds of decisions 10 years ago, and we can see the benefits and the accident stats have gone down, all that kind of stuff. So that's why I'll be, if it's to support the hybrid one, I'll vote against that one. Again, not out of any disrespect to the tremendous work that the commission and I did watch it on the, I wasn't there in person, but I saw it on the cable, and I'm very, very happy with the caliber and the quality of the conversation there. And some excellent points were made all the way around. But in terms of the intention of what this design is meant to do is the exact thing that you're aware of. You want people to not be zipping along at 60 miles an hour on that thing. You want them to be more conscious of their surroundings and aware of other vehicles and bicyclists and people in a wheelchair and people in a stroller and that kind of stuff as we all try to get along. So that's kind of the intent behind, as Amy so aptly described with the complete streets thing. So that's just where I'm coming from.
Very good.
Yeah, thank you.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just to very quickly, preemptively explain why I'm voting the way I'm voting on this. I actually tend to agree with my colleague, Steve, and there are just some other things. The hybrid option of the Planning Commission came up with is the best option. I'm not sure that I really like any of them as they are laid out, I think, which is kind of why I'm more leaning towards voting no, not because I disagree with what they – I think their option makes a lot of sense, but there are some elements in the first one that I think are critical that we lose when we shift to that one. So just so everyone's aware of why I'm voting no, I'm not really crazy about what we have in front of us, and I know that, as you said, there's no funding, and this is a long ways off, but – I am casting a stone right now for let's do another option on this. Thank you.
Very good. Anyone else want to weigh in on this? I mean, we can all see the pluses and my. Oh, we have somebody in the audience?
Yeah.
Yes. Come to them. Oh, David.
Chair. Yes.
Chairman. Mr. Chairman.
Indeed.
Thanks. When we were looking at this in. And we looked at it, how we would deal with the automobiles parking. One of the concerns I had, and some of the members of the planning, and all of the members of the Planning Commission, we just went through a tremendous discussion a few months back about parking and moving and where we do park our cars, especially on Woodward. And I believe it was several years ago that we looked at that with the WA3, and they had proposed that we draw a line into the neighborhood for parking along Woodward Avenue. And I think we've all seen in recent times what happens when we start to go into the neighborhood. And we do have several businesses along Woodward right now that have very limited parking, and the only parking they really have is in the on the frontage of Woodward. And so I was concerned, and so was the Planning Commission, concerned about how we handle parking. I attended a meeting in Lansing a couple years ago, and I listened to a gentleman from Birmingham who deals with businesses and promoting how businesses and development of commercial property within the towns and cities. And one of his issues was that you really need on-street parking. It's helpful because you get people who can come in, pull in, park, get out of the car, go in, get out, get back out on the street. So it's important for that. And when I looked at this whole idea, the two things that bothered me the most was having that parking, having those cars farther out away from the businesses and parking out onto the street and then having bike lanes inside and pedestrians and all that. And I feel better. I know how public safety feels. I know I don't like driving down a street with a car parked right next to me and somebody fly opens the door or whatever. And I see a lot of that. When I drive Woodward every morning. And sometimes I drive it home at night, but lately you can't with all the mess going on down in Detroit. But I feel that bike lane being next to the cars is detrimental for getting people in to be afraid to come in and park into the right of into the areas closer to the street. So I like kind of having the bike lane closer because to the sidewalk, because I think that can help attract those folks to participate in the activities of what's transpiring on the sidewalks and be closer to business. If they want to run in and get an ice cream cone or whatever they want to do, stop, get something to eat, they can park their bike and go and then get back in and go. And I think it's much safer for the bicyclists. And I think it's also much safer for having the cars inside there also, because then people can move down Woodward. We have to remember that Woodward Avenue is still a road of commerce. And the assumption is that they are going to take the traffic calming and lower the speed limit on Woodward to something other than 45 in areas like ours, I would assume that, because you're going to be narrowing it down to three lanes. So there's going to be more traffic out there, especially when you go to three lanes. And I don't want to get into the bus rapid transit, but right now it looks like the left lane is going to be gone on Woodward. We don't know that for sure, but that's... So that was some of the thinking that went into building this hybrid plan, was making it more friendly for businesses along Woodward, because that's part of what we're trying to do here, is to be able to attract people into the businesses along Woodward. And surely, this is a long way out, and all the whole Woodward can change. I've sat on the Planning Commission long enough to see one business. We've redone one business two or three times now, because they come and they go. And of course, that's going to happen, continue to happen. So my expression is, that's sort of why I voted for the hybrid, because I think it's the best of what I've seen and what we've put together. Because quite honestly, I didn't like the first one, and I really didn't like all of the second one, and quite frankly, I don't like any of them. But the hybrid was the closest one that seemed to make the most sense. So thank you.
Any questions for Chairman Burnett while we have him at the microphone? Thank you for the enormous work. I think everybody on the council watched that Planning Commission and listened to the deliberations and the care and concern for safety and traffic and people. Nice job.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Councilmember Kadeckel.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Commissioner Burnett and Amy and the Planning Commission for all the work they've done. The number one word I have in my mind is safety. And the further the bikes are away from the road, I think the smarter it would be. Even on Coolidge and 12 Mile Road, it's not always easy to get in and out of your car. And I mean, granted, they would have to lower the speed on Woodward in order to make this work. So as everyone or others have mentioned, I don't like any of them, but I like the hybrid the most. And listening to the dialogue at your meeting last week, I'm definitely convinced that would be the way to go.
Very good. Councilor Baker.
Thank you again, and agreed. I think safety is instrumental here as we think about this, and some of the points that I recall as well was around the speed at which bicycles travel. I mean, sometimes those guys are pushing 20 miles an hour, and I wouldn't want to get hit by one of those as a pedestrian, especially if I'm pushing a stroller or something like that. So one of the things that the cyclist community understands, there's stickers to this effect: same road, same rules, same rights. And so that is to remind them that it is a vehicle and you drive this thing and it goes fast. And so I don't think of a bicycle so much as a pedestrian thing, but more as a motion, locomotion kind of thing. And so agreed, none of these are perfectly ideal. And I wish we did have more options to play with as well. And as I think about some of the other options that are in here, it keeps the bicycles a little closer to, other types of vehicles, recognizing that they have a responsibility, right? Some of the other good points about some cyclists don't really respect the responsibilities that they have, and that's a serious issue that needs to be dealt with as well. So
I agree with that.
Anything else? Councilman Radger.
In the hybrid, is the bike lane two lanes or one lane? One lane as well?
There's not enough room to do that. Then they would have had to pick which side of Woodward got it. So in this way, they've done it as one lane. I don't know that it'll operate, or as one way. Don't know how it will end up operating,
Okay.
Very good. Well, this is a moving target. It's a vision, and it probably will see other iterations as we go forward. But for now, we must take a vote. And Ms. Vecchio, please call the roll on M3615, which, reminding everybody, is the hybrid version proposed by the Planning Commission.
Studman?
Yes.
Terbrick?
No.
Baker?
No.
Blanchard?
Yes.
Edgar?
Yes.
Kadeckel?
Yes.
O'Dwyer?
Yes. And now, Ms. Vecchio, would you please read item number 10?
Motion number M3715, matter of approving the Berkley City Manager Jane Bace DeSessa as the City of Berkeley's representative, and Public Works Director Derek Schuler as the alternate representative to the Southeastern Oakland County Resource Recovery Authority, SACRA, Board of Trustees for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015, and to instruct the City Clerk to send a copy of this motion to the SACRA Board.
Is there a motion to approve M3715?
Motion to approve.
Support.
Motion to approve by Councilmember Edgar with support by Councilmember Blanchard. Ms. DeSessa.
Mr. Mayor, City Council, this item comes before you once a year. I'm recommending that you consider this as well favorably. I've been doing this for many years. Mr. Schuler and I are good teammates when it comes to this, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions for the City Manager on this recurring item? Very good. Then, Ms. Vecchio, how about calling the roll on M3715?
Terbrick.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
Blanchard.
Yes.
Edgar.
Yes.
Kadeckel.
Yes.
Studman.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. Now, Ms. Vecchio, would you please read item number 11?
Motion number M3815, matter of appointing the Berkeley Public Works Director Derek Schuler as the City of Berkeley's representative, and Finance Director David Sabuda as the alternate representative to the Southeastern Oakland County Water Authority, SACWA, Board of Trustees for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015, and to instruct the City Clerk to send a copy of this motion to the SACWA Board.
Is there a motion to approve M3815?
Move to approve.
Move to approve by Councilmember Kadeckel. Support by Councilmember Blanchard. Ms. DeSessa.
Again, Council, this is something that appears before you on an annual basis. I am recommending this for your consideration. Both Mr. Schuler and Mr. Sabuda have done an excellent job, and I would concur or recommend that you please approve this recommendation.
Any discussion on this item? Again, a recurring item every year. Ms. Vecchio, would you please call the roll on M3815?
Baker.
Yes.
Blanchard.
Yes.
Edgar.
Yes.
Kadeckel.
Yes.
Studman.
Yes.
Terbrick.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. Now, Ms. Feck, could you please read item number 12?
Motion number M3915, matter of appointing the Berkeley Information Technology Coordinator, Stan Lisica, as the City of Berkeley's interim representative to the Community Media Network Board, CMN, and to instruct the City Clerk to send a copy of this motion to CMN.
Is there a motion to approve M3915?
Motion to approve.
Motion support. Moved by Councilmember Baker, support by Councilmember Edgar. Ms. DeSessa.
Council, as I said, this is an interim recommendation until I appoint the new cable position, as they call it. CMN, actually, right now we're working with them, and they are they're videotaping this program for us. And I'm still working with them to see how perhaps we could improve our relationship, and we'll see where we go with that. But for now, until I do that, and until I fill this position, I respectfully ask that you consider my recommendation to approve on an interim basis Mr. Stan Lisica, our IT coordinator.
Very good. Councilor Baker.
Thank you. That was my only actual clarifying question. Is the at the agenda it does say interim, but in the actual packet material on the end, that word is omitted. I just wasn't sure if that was an oversight or which way we had intended.
It would just be interim, Your Honor.
Okay.
Unless something happens, and you know, when we do the review, we'll come back and we'll make him permanent if that's the case.
If he wants it. Thank you. I think.
But for now, we're yep. looking at just interim.
Okay.
Very good.
Sure. Good luck.
He's already attended one meeting.
Very good. Any further discussion? Hearing none, then Ms. Vecchio, would you please call the roll on M3915?
Blanchard.
Yes.
Edgar.
Yes.
Kadeckel.
Yes.
Studman.
Yes.
Terbrick.
Yes.
Baker.
Yes.
O'Dwyer.
Yes. And now we come to the communications portion of tonight's meeting. and I wasn't paying attention. So, Ms. Vecchio, who's up? Councilmember Edgar. Is it?
I believe it's Edgar.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just real quick, I know it's late. Just want to thank the Planning Commission for their incredible work, as always. Just amazing diligence and fortitude that they put into every proposal that comes before them. We're going to have an awfully exciting couple of summer months with Art Bash, music on Robina, new technology popping up, new homes being planned, complete streets, hopes and dreams, and let's hope some warm weather. That's all tonight, sir.
Very good. Councilor Cadet.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have a few things tonight. I had the pleasure on May 28th of attending the celebration for 175 years of excellence for the Berkley School District. It was a real nice ceremony. They have a plaque right across the street from the school. We had a 99-year-old Art Secord unveiled the plaque because he's been here that long. So I want to congratulate Superintendent McDavid and the entire school district for that. The plaque only says 150 years because that's all the Michigan Historical Committee allows. Memorial Day ceremonies, once again, were very moving. This past week, or last Monday, I want to thank Berkeley's Honor Guard. They always do a great job, along with the VFW Post 922 and American Legion Post 374. This Saturday on June 6th, Dad's Club is having opening day. From at 10 o'clock, their parade will start from the high school to Community One. Hot dogs and raffles will be there, and also prizes for the kids. I want to congratulate a businesswoman in Berkeley, Nikki Mabey. She owned Salon Simply Beautiful, and she had a nice question and answer article in yesterday's Free Press, and I walked in the salon today, and it's just a very pleasant lady. So if you get a chance, you can stop by there. And finally, before the next council meeting, I want to wish our colleague, Council Member Stedman, a very happy birthday. And don't forget your Jack's Car Wash.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
Mayor. Pro Tem Terbrack.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As we are now officially in June and school is going to be getting out very soon, I want to run down some events that will be coming up in the Parks and Rec Department, try to help Art out as much as I can here with some advertising. We've got a couple different sections. The first up is our special event section coming up. So the Berkeley Community Garage Sale is going to be Friday, June 26th, Saturday, June 27th. You sign up at the Community Center, $20 for new homes, $10 for returning homes that still have their signs, and $25 for a table at the community center. So again, that's the community garage sale coming up Friday, June 26th, and Saturday, June 27th. Just prior to that, we have Tot Lot Night, Wednesday, June 24th, from 5 to 8 p.m. Very important, don't forget your swimsuit. I did not bring my swimsuit last year, nor did my children, and they just came home wet. So if you bring your swimsuit, it's much better. Again, Wednesday, June 24th, 5 to 8 at the Tot Lot. Now looking forward to when those youngsters are out of school and looking for things to do. We have great summer camps coming up. Day camp begins June 15th. It's a three-day-a-week minimum, and you can contact the Parks and Recreation Director for more information. He will gladly give you that information. Again, that summer day camps beginning June 15th, right after school gets out. We have some basketball camps coming up. For boys, grades 4 through 10, it'll be June 15th through June 19th. So boys grades 4 through 10, June 15th to 19th from 8 a.m. to 12 noon. And girls, grades 3 to 8, June 15th to 19th from 12:30 to 3. So again, girls, grades 3 through 8, June 15th through 19th. From 12:30 to 3 p.m. Soccer camp, Skyhawk soccer camp, boys and girls ages 5 to 11. That will be June 15th through 19th from 9 to 11. So again, that's Skyhawk soccer camp for boys and girls ages 5 to 11, June 15th through the 19th from 9 to 11. and girls volleyball camp, grades 5 through 9, June 22nd through June 26th, and that is 3 to 5:30 p.m. So volleyball camp, grades 5 to 9, girls volleyball camp, June 22nd through the 26th from 3 to 5:30, and stay tuned for more Summerfest information to come. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Baker.
That's awesome. Well, I too would like to thank again my colleagues for the great interaction that we've had tonight. When I think about the deliberations and thoroughness with which we explore these issues, and whether it's something that we hope to implement very soon or if it's something that's 10 years into the future, it shows that we have a robust dialogue and the diverse perspectives that we bring to the topics here that help shape and advance the city and our community. I think that's fantastic. And speaking of the future and things looking out into the horizon there, as was mentioned earlier, the Regional Transit Authority, the RTA, recently had a series of open house sessions, which were open to the public, and opportunities for folks around the four counties that make up the RTA, a chance to understand what's going on. Those of us here in this neck of the woods have had a little bit more exposure to the topic of public transit, especially along Woodward Corridor. Those of us know that that Berkley has been involved with that for 5 or 6 years now. In the most recent run, obviously, it's transit conversations have been going on for a long time. But for many around the region, this is their first meaningful conversation about what a transit system might do for them, for the businesses, for their schools, for their families, for recreation, entertainment, things like that. And so those sessions were well-received, well-attended, and great feedback and questions came about as a result of that. Folks attended who would eagerly use transit systems, and folks showed up who had no interest in using a transit system. And it was interesting conversations across the board there, you know, from those who obviously want to use transit, can see all the benefits of it, and those that don't want to use transit come out ahead too, right? Because although there may be a compression in the lanes, especially when we have a surplus of turf out there, there'll be, you know, fewer other drivers you have to deal with and more parking available to you, that kind of stuff. For those who choose to take transit, we get out of your way, you know? So that kind of stuff is pretty cool. And lots more to come. As was mentioned, this was just another stage in that journey of engaging us in dialogue about what it could be and what it might mean, the benefits it could bring again to us as residents and businesses and kids and shoppers and people who want to go to the ball game, all that good stuff too. So I actually wanted to pause on this for a second. Paraphrase Barry Eisler, who once said something to the effect of, anger is both the cause and the consequence of self-righteousness. Again, that's anger is both the cause and the consequence of self-righteousness. And that stuck in my head for the longest time, and it popped up again a couple weeks back, driving along, doing whatever, because we don't have regional transit. Did I say that out loud?
Yes.
And somebody just cuts me off, like bang, out of nowhere, you know, no contact. So it's like, holy smokes, what just happened? And my reaction was to get upset. You know, this isn't nice. I'm doing my thing, and they just whoop, cut right over. I thought about how unsafe that was, and you know, who was that guy or whatever, you know. And then later that same week, I was on that same stretch of road, and it was a different time of day. The volume was less, and I actually was in that next lane that this person had cut over from, and there was a huge pothole right there. And so now I see that same thing that happened earlier from a completely different perspective. You know, here he's just trying to, oh, my goodness, you know, and of course it wasn't the best idea to change lanes at high speed without signaling and stuff like that, but at least I understood what could have been going through that person's head as they were just trying to protect whoever was in their vehicle and that kind of stuff too. And so I saw that same scene through a different lens, and that got me thinking, you know, it's the exact same thing that happened, but my awareness and perception of it is different now. And I got to thinking, well, what was I thinking, that this guy was just an idiot and thoughtless? And so that kind of got me thinking about the source of anger or frustration that I had felt. And I said, I did that to myself, right? My own self-righteousness really kind of spun me up unnecessarily. And so I offer that quote, not for you guys to change your behavior if you don't choose to, but at least to say, here's what I'm going to be thinking about when I get these kind of weird feelings of irritation or upset or whatever. It's like, what am I doing? What am I missing? What additional information would help me think about this differently, rather than just getting off on my high horse and saying some things that doesn't help anybody anyway, especially blood pressure and all that kind of stuff. So again, I just offer that anger is both the cause and the consequence of self-righteousness. It's interesting. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Councilmember Stedman.
Okay, the library is going into their summer program. They're closed on Saturdays and Sundays now. And June 15th, which is a Monday, and it's a council meeting Monday, from 6 to 8 p.m., summer reading kickoff and ice cream social. The friends of the library will be scooping ice cream. They request a dollar donation. And this is also the first time that everybody can, people of all ages can sign up for this year's summer reading programs. And there's going to be prizes, including two Kindles. In terms of other summer programs, on Tuesday, June the 16th at 6:30 p.m., they are going to have Roots of Music. This sounds really interesting for anybody who grew up around here. Origins of the Motown Sound. And this sounds very interesting. You can call the library to make a reservation, and it will delve into the city's history of music making and the connection between the Motown sound and Detroit culture and the elements that contributed to the unique stylings of Motown and Tamla Records. The other program that's coming up at the library in June is Friday, June 26th at 2 o'clock p.m. And it's about downloadable ebooks, audiobooks, or magazines. So it's instructions on how to do that. Download ebooks, audiobooks, or magazines to your Kindle or your iPad or other device. So if you don't know how to do that and you would like to, call and make an appointment with or make a reservation to attend that program. That's all I have tonight.
Thank you. Councilmember Blanchard.
Thank you, Your Honor. Two major events coming up, the Berkley Art Bash and Lids for Kids will be held on June 13th. This year, the Art Bash will be on 12 Mile Road between Wakefield and Buckingham. It's been moved one block west. There will be more artists this year. There will also be food booths, kid games, and all emergence along there will have sidewalk sales. Lids for Kids will stress bike safety and provide bike helmets to those kids that need them. The hours of the Art Bash will run from 10 to 6. Lids for Kids will run from 10 to 2. Keep in mind that 12 Mile Road will be closing that morning at 6 a.m. and not reopening till approximately 10 p.m. so that we can get things set up, torn down, and the street cleaned and open again. The American Legion will be having a fish fry on Friday the 5th of June. So thank you for your support of the American Legion, and that's all I have tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Sesson.
Council, I try to be brief. Again, to members of the public, please visit our website at berkeleymich.org so that if you didn't get all the details that some of the council members mentioned, you can get that on our website. And while you're at our website, I ask everybody to please download two things. One is our mobile app, which is Access Berkeley, and I'm hoping that everyone will do that as well. And then also, secondly, to subscribe to our newsletter. This is a monthly newsletter that the mayor puts out, and he gives an update report to the citizens of our community. And I know you get a lot of response on that, Mr. Mayor, so it's very good. I recommend that. I know that we also announced any new programs that are coming. I know I'm signing up for the Motown. I hope they get to play music, so that I'm excited about that. The Cruise Fest is coming right up, August 14th. People are already out there lining the streets as we speak even now. So it's already starting. So August 14th is just right around the corner. Also, let everyone know that City Council is going to go into summer mode starting July. So we'll be meeting the third Monday of each month. So we'll have one meeting up until September. And then we'll go back into our meeting twice a month. So we'll be into summer mode starting July 1st. And for the public out there, at the last council meeting, the City Council approved a branding study. That was very important. We're going to be working on the development of a new logo and a new tagline for the City of Berkeley. And staff and I are working on identifying individuals that will assist us in determining exactly what that new logo will look like. But one of the key things that the City Council mentioned at the last meeting was to find a way where residents in our community can have some say. They may not all join or come to our meetings, but you can comment on what you would like or what you think of the city of Berkeley so that we can develop this logo. And we're probably going to launch this early next week, where we're going to have a questionnaire or a survey that residents can fill out, and they can just send it in to us electronically, and our consultants can utilize this information to help in the development of this logo. So please, residents, and I'd say even interested citizens that live outside our community, if you have some opinion of what you think Berkeley is like, please fill out the survey and let us know. And it's coming.
Then move. So,
yes.
Then move into Berkeley.
Then move to Berkeley. So thank you, Your Honor. That's all I have.
Thank you. Mr. Attorney.
Just a couple of things tonight. We've been very busy with a lot of city-related matters. One item that we're working with the clerk's office with that we didn't quite have time to get to you at this meeting, but we'll have to get it to you the next meeting, and that is some changes to the city's freedom of information policy to comply with the new law and the new fee structure that will be going into effect on July 1. So we can, I guess, look forward or not look forward to that coming at your next meeting, but that's coming. Also, just to advise council, we're looking forward, Dan, Chris, and I, to transitioning starting this week to the new courthouse, or new to us anyway, in Royal Oak. We didn't have court last week, and prior to that, of course, we'd been handling city cases right here, right in this room, this very room. So we are looking forward to getting acclimated to the new court and actually having a room to work in that at least two people at a time can sit down in. So we have that going. The last thing I really want to mention tonight is Ms. DeSessa reminded me of it when she made reference to, you know, summer, in spite of yesterday's weather, summer being upon us. Summer in Michigan means fireworks season also. Although there was some talk, maybe even a small buzz in the state legislature over the last 12 months or so about possibly amending the fireworks statute to restore more local authority. It hasn't happened. But having said that, we do have an ordinance in the city. I just want to remind council, as well as those listening and watching this meeting, that we do have an ordinance that fireworks in Michigan and in the city of Berkeley are prohibited, except on the designated days, which the next one coming up, of course, will be Independence Day, and it's the Independence Day, the day before, and the day after. And there is a midnight cap on that. You can't just go on a three-day fireworks festival. You do have to be respectful and considerate of the neighbors and keep it on your own property, and it all has to stop by midnight. So depending on your point of view, that's part of the good and bad that comes with our summertime. So that's coming up, and I'm sure we'll be talking more about that as the date approaches in another just a little over a month. And that's it for my report this evening.
Very good. Thank you. This was a wonderful meeting. I want to congratulate my colleagues on the deliberation, the care, and discussion regarding the future. We were talking principally tonight about vision for how our community is going to be. And the changes that will happen whether we are part of crafting how they change or not. And so it is wonderful to see the energy and enthusiasm and passion to create that vision of how Woodward could be and how it might be, to see how our city might move in the direction of building some townhouses and condos that would meet the needs of many of our residents. The branding study that seeks to capture that elusive Berkley vibe, that characteristic feature that is this city, that so many people admire and want to be part of. And yet we also have current immediate celebrations, the Art Bash, Robina Rhapsody, and so a wonderful blend of vision for the future with celebration of what we have at present. And I am reminded by the ancient proverb, where there is no vision, the people perish. And I'm thankful that my colleagues work well on crafting a vision for our community, and we will continue that task going forward. Meanwhile, we manage our budget like we did at the last meeting, so that the funds are there to do the things that we want to do, to reflect the values and hopes and dreams of the people of this city. And so, on that note, is there a motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
Move to adjourn by Councilmember Kadeckel, and supported by Councilmember Steadman. Call the roll, please.
Edgar?
Yes.
Kadeckel?
Yes.
Steadman?
Yes.
Terbrick?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
Blanchard?
Yes.
O'Dwyer?
Yes. The June 1st meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
I have to apologize. I meant to mention. I knew.